Don't let's be beastly to the Germans when our victory is ultimately won. It was just those nasty Nazis who persuaded them to fight, and their Beethoven and Bach are really far worse than their bite.
We're delighted to be here in the wonderful surroundings of the Noël Coward Theatre to discuss Noël Coward's lesser known, little performed play, Peace in Our Time. Before we get started, and I introduce you to the panel guests who are here with me on the stage today, we're very delighted that the voice of Sir Noël Coward is actually able to join us this morning, courtesy of Stephen Critchlow. And I'm going to leave it to him now to introduce you and set the scene for episode one of the play Peace in Our Time.
Setting: The Shy Gazelle. A small public house not very far from Sloane Square. The month, November. The year, 1940. Behind the bar are the pub's manager, Fred Shattock, his wife, Nora, and Doris, the couple's daughter. Fred's been in the publican business since 1919, when he came out of the army and married Nora. Doris, the daughter, is a pretty girl. She works as a receptionist at the Savoy, but helps out at the pub in her spare time. The place is quite busy tonight. The new arrival's name is Alma Borton. She's well-dressed and talkative, works as a buyer, does a lot of traveling. At their customary table by the window are Mr. and Mrs. Granger, a commonplace couple. And seated at the bar are Lyra Vivian and George Bourne. Lyra is a rather spectacular-looking woman, a cabaret artist of some repute, born and brought up in the hunting counties. She's what might be technically described as a lady, but morally, she's the casualty of those hectic early 20s. She threw her bonnet over rather too many windmills. George Bourne has been Lyra's lover sporadically for 2 years. He's well-dressed, wealthy, and apparently has no employment. Janet Braid's a writer, plainly dressed, ordinary looking. One can't help feeling that the light's gone out in her. Her son was shot down and killed in the Battle of Britain. And Chorley Bannister comes under the heading of intellectual. Not in the fullest sense, but merely insofar as he's well-read, intelligent, and edits a highbrow magazine called Forethought. Affected. Inclined to be over-provocative, devoid of moral integrity and easily frightened. He can, however, be witty on occasions.
Thanks for that splendid introduction to from the opening scene of Peace in Our Time. I'm going to read what Coward wrote as his inspiration for the play. Sadly, I can't do the voice quite as well as Stephen can. I don't think anybody can. But Coward himself wrote that the idea of Peace in Our Time was conceived in Paris shortly after the liberation. I began to suspect that the physical effect of 4 years of intermittent bombing is far less damaging to the intrinsic character of a nation than the spiritual effect of 4 years enemy occupation. This in time led me to wonder what might have happened to London and England if, in 1940, the Germans had successfully invaded and occupied us, which they so very nearly did. Thus, when writing the play Peace in Our Time, Coward imagined what might have happened if the Battle of Britain had been lost in 1940, and he went on to explore the dramatic theme of German occupation of London through unfolding events in the saloon bar of a pub called the Shy Gazelle near Sloane Street, which was based on Coward's own local pub, between November 1940 and May 1945. So to help us to consider the play in greater depth and to explore the wartime experiences that might have influenced Sir Noël to write the play and to examine the challenges involved in adapting the play for radio, I would like to introduce the members of our discussion panel. So to my left, formerly a reader in drama at the University of Sheffield, Francis Gray has written books on comedy, crime writing and radio drama, as well as several books related to Sir Noël Coward, including a full-length study, a contribution to the Coward Centenary volume in 2003, and to several studies of British theatre. Brian, who's sitting to my right, Brian Fillis, I understand your television debut was your critically acclaimed BBC adaptation of your cult comic play about the great cook hostess Fanny Craddock, and that was called Fear of Fanny. Other work includes writing the BBC 4 drama The Curse of Steptoe, and that you also wrote the screenplay for the film An Englishman in New York, based on the second instalment of Quentin Crisp's life. And you've also recently completed a screenplay based on Coward's experiences during the Second World War. Great, and we'll come to talk about that in a moment. Sitting next to Brian, we have cultural historian Katy Layton-Jones. She's published very widely for academic, public and professional readerships. You hold a research post at the University of Leicester and lecture for the Open University. And you produce a lot of research publications for people like English Heritage and all over the place, don't you? A little bit further down the line here is dramatist Martin Wade. Martin's written many plays and adaptations for radio. I understand your play Singles and Doublets won a BBC Radio Drama Award in 2013, which is rather marvellous. Your recent credits include The Healing of Sergei Rachmaninoff and Murin's Last Symphony. But also, more importantly, for today's proceedings, you adapted Coward's Peace in Our Time for radio for our recent production for digital drama. We have Kate Valentine on the end here. Kate directed the recent radio adaptation of Peace in Our Time for digital drama. I think after stumbling on the play in a secondhand bookshop, Kate, and was quite surprised that she'd never even heard of this play, as many people have not, because it's very little produced. Kate's worked in the theatre from the London Fringe to the Stephen Josephson in Scarborough and the National Theatre, and has produced a lot of plays for BBC Radio 3 and 4. And we're also absolutely delighted to have Geoffrey Johnson with us this morning. Some of you from the Noël Coward Society who are here with us today may have met Geoffrey before. Geoffrey was Sir Noël Coward's representative in America for several years during the 1960s and the early 70s. And he was fortunate to know and work with Sir Noël, and we're absolutely delighted that you're able to join us all the way from New York today. Geoffrey, thank you so much. And also supporting us this morning are actors Dorothy Atkinson, Adrian McLaughlin, and Stephen Critchlow, who performed in our recent radio adaptation of Peace in Our Time. And it's great that they're able to join us today to revisit some of the sections of the play which we're going to be talking about. So we hope you enjoy the morning. Thank you. I should actually say I didn't introduce myself. My name's Alison Ramsey and I produce the radio drama of Peace in Our Time. So, firstly, to get our discussion kicked off, Francis, I would like to ask you, I know you've done a lot of research and you've written a lot about Coward's work, particularly about his plays. Could you tell us a little bit about some of the plays that Coward wrote about war generally, and your feeling about how those plays were, you know, the response perhaps from the audience to those plays?
Yeah, he didn't have very much luck with writing about war, not so much in terms of the quality of the plays, but the fact that they weren't very well timed from the audience point of view. I mean, the first one you could really call a war play, I suppose, was called Postmortem. And he wrote it in 1930. It's about a man dying in the trenches who actually visits 1930 as a ghost and is horrified to find what's happened, including the fact that war appears to be inevitable again. That's a kind of note throughout Coward's pre-war plays that are looking forward. That sense that it's not over. The next war is just round the corner. He's much more at ease, I think, saying that in something like The Vortex, where it isn't the subject. Mm. But when he's writing about the war, if you look at something like This Happy Breed, which is an exploration of a family rather like the one who run the Shy Gazelle. They've got very similar names, in fact. And it starts in 1919 and goes through to 1939. And it's a very interesting play about standing and keeping fast and holding tight But by the time it actually got on, we'd been through the Blitz, and it was a bit inadequate as a response to what was going on then, as I'm sure he felt himself. I mean, I mean, for me, actually, the most successful war play, in a weird sort of way, is Blithe Spirit, because it was written during a very dark time, and it was put on during an even darker one. There were bombs actually dropping on the theatre as he wrote it. And it says a lot about the shortness of life, and actually his ghastly hero doesn't value life at all, which is what makes him so much the most obnoxious, I suppose, of all the big comedies, really.
And thinking about Peace in Our Time, I mean, obviously that was Coward writing about very recent events of the Second World War. It didn't open for very long. I think it opened first in Brighton and then it moved to the West End. Do you have some thoughts about his reasoning for writing the play and reasons for the reaction to the play at the time in 1947 when it was first put on the West End stage?
I mean, I think you've explained some of the reasons for writing it very well. It does reflect some of his own experience during the war in Paris. Binky Beaumont didn't like it. So I suspect it was never, ever going to have a very long run. I think part of the problem with the play at the time was that it is rather gloomy fare for people who've been through so many years of war and are now living through post-war austerity. And there is a tendency of some of the more appealing characters to kind of take for granted things like, oh, the class war was a lot of silly nonsense. And I don't think the audience who were, certainly the people up in the gallery who voted Labour, might not have thought that Churchill being voted out of office was the worst disaster that had ever befallen us, and perhaps weren't in a mood to appreciate that. I mean, I was born the year it opened. Oh. I could have watched it as a fetus. And I think if I'd had any thoughts, they might have been, actually, I like my free orange juice and I like the education I'm going to get, thank you very much. So I think there was a certain kind of reaction to that aspect of the play that perhaps swamped some of the very strong features that it has got. I think.
May I interrupt you? It did get very good, what we would call reviews, but notices, did it not?
It certainly got a big response from the first audience.
Right, that's what I thought. Yeah. Yes, and before my time too, but even me.
And I think there are other reasons why it's possibly difficult to stage this play frequently, which I think we'll probably explore a little bit later when we're thinking about why it was such a good candidate to make a radio adaptation from. In terms of, I think you've mentioned that you feel that perhaps one of the characters in Peace in Our Time might be reflective of Coward's character, that it might have been a character that he perhaps might have written himself into that character. Could you elaborate a little bit about that?
I think if he was going to, well, he couldn't have played it, but I think he was Janet more than any of the other characters.
That's the character Janet Braid.
Yeah.
I mean, you've got this novelist who has got all that kind of patriotic energy that she makes speeches pretty much like the one he made at the end of Cavalcade when he said it was a pretty exciting thing to be English. But she's also at this great distance. She's out in the country and kind of zooms in occasionally to make a patriotic speech. And I do wonder whether the fact that it's her fault, actually, that little resistance cell gets blown, because she sounded off at a very inopportune moment, is a kind of slight feeling guilty about his lack of involvement in the First War, which did seem to haunt him quite a lot in the 30s, that he thought he hadn't done enough at that point.
Well, I think, yes, absolutely. And also, and obviously, we're going to perhaps move on to some of the work that Coward did do in the war, apart from his writing. He was obviously doing work which we'll get onto later, but could you give an explanation of the kind of war work that he wanted to be involved in and was involved in during the war?
He did go to Churchill and ask for a proper job in intelligence, and apparently Churchill completely misunderstood what he was asking for. and told him, go off and sing while the guns are firing, which left him very, very downhearted. He wanted to make a real contribution and wrote very acidly to say that if you sing while the guns are firing, everybody's going to be too busy firing the guns to listen, aren't they?
And he wanted to be more involved and did become more involved in espionage work, which I think we'll get onto a little bit later in our discussion. Well, I think that probably it's time for another section of the play, and our actors are going to read another part of episode one from the radio adaptation of the play. So I'll hand over to them.
Good evening.
Good evening, sir.
A whiskey and soda, please.
Double or single?
Single, please.
That'll be 1 and 6 pence, please, Mr. Rixer.
1 and 6 pence.
Thank you.
Here's how. Have you a light? Thank you. Quite busy, I see. Yes, quite busy. Well, good night, Mrs. Shattuck.
Good night.
Good night, Mr. Shattuck.
Good night, sir.
What did you want to call him sir for?
Well, he's a customer, isn't he?
Thank you for that marvellous exploration. That was the interaction between Nora and Fred Shattuck, who are the publicans of the Shy Gazelle in the play, where all the whole of the play is set in the pub, and Albrecht Richter, who is the main German Nazi officer figure who is in the play. Now, obviously, that brings us on to the question of why did Coward set Peace in Our Time in this fictitious setting that the Germans could have occupied Britain, and what the consequences were? I suppose that raises a question: how likely was it that that Germany could have invaded Britain during the Second World War? And I'm going to ask you that question, Katy, as a cultural historian. Was it likely that the Germans would have invaded? How likely do you think it is?
I think it's one of those rare instances where the general public today underestimate the likelihood of Britain having been invaded in the Second World War. And I think when you look at the historical record, particularly the military leadership, the political leadership in Britain is absolutely convinced that they will be invaded. And they are waiting for it. They are literally looking out to sea and awaiting the invasion. So although Coward's writing this after the Second World War and with the hindsight of knowing it's, you know, safe from such a risk, there is an absolute belief that that would happen. There's very clear evidence, actually, that there's a commitment to protecting Britain in the event of an invasion. And of course, we could never know if it would have been successful to the extent that Coward uses it in his play. But there's over 1.5 million people in the Home Guard, which has to be resourced, funded, trained. That's explicitly, intentionally, to defend Britain in the case of invasion. In September, in fact, in 1940, after at the end of the 3 months of real great risk of invasion, General Brooke writes in his own diary, "Still no invasion!" Exclamation mark. He absolutely can't believe that they haven't done it. Had they invaded, it's very likely they could at least have taken a grip in the south of England. And Churchill himself, in discussion with Hastings Ismay, one of his very closest military advisors, says to him, "We'll be dead in 3 months." At Dunkirk, when they sit around afterwards and they reflect upon their position, he's absolutely certain that they will be invaded, and he really perceives that he will himself be dead within 3 months. And that's the political and military leadership of Britain. So whether or not the British people really understood the grave risk they were at, we can't tell. But we do know that officially the expectation was very real.
And there was, I think that, you know, after the war it was found, I think the plans for a potential invasion of Britain were discovered. Am I right in thinking that?
Yeah, so Operation Sea Lion, which is the broad plan to invade Britain, which includes within it a very detailed study of the geology of Britain, of its political leadership, of its municipal organisation, that existed and was shelved, actually. in 1941, and it's only through the invasion of Russia and Hitler being distracted elsewhere that it is shelved, but it's never completely dismissed. It's always hanging as this little kind of warning in the background, and it's very revealing. If you think about our own invasion, if you think about Operation Overlord, where the British and American forces and the Allies invade continental Europe, that was seen as risky, that was seen as potentially unsuccessful. The Germans didn't believe we'd land in Normandy. Well, the same applies to Sea Line. Parts of it are clearly flawed. There was a relatively weak strategy once they gained a foothold, but that was the case with Overlord, and we succeeded. So there was always every chance that Hitler and the Wehrmacht might just take a gamble and invoke Operation Sea Lion, even when the weight of chance had actually moved against them.
So it was a very, it was clearly very, very real
very
threat.
Real.
And I suppose that, Coward had experience of working in Paris at the beginning of the war and would have experienced, I think, a lot of the work that he did based Peace in Our Time on was coming out of his experiences of what had happened in France under occupation. And so, it was based on a real likelihood that such a thing could have happened in Britain. Mm. I think that leads us rather nicely on to our next extract from the play from our actors. We've got an exchange here from episode 3 of the radio adaptation of the play. Just exploring some of the interactions of the occupying forces with our British bartenders, the people running the pub, and I'll hand over to the actors to take over.
Would you be kind enough to answer me a question, Mr. Shattuck?
What is it?
You, I take it, represent a certain class in this country. Shall we say the middle class? That is so, is it not?
I'm a publican. That might mean any class.
Let the gentleman ask his question, Fred.
The question is this. In your opinion, how long will it take ordinary, decently educated, hard-working people like yourselves to be reconciled to the inevitable?
Inevitable? How do you mean?
Owing to the fortunes of war and superior equipment, determination and power, my country has taken possession of yours and will remain in possession for many years, possibly forever. This is inevitable.
Is it?
Obviously.
Do you think that our dominions overseas and our friends in America are going to allow you to occupy this country indefinitely?
They will have no choice in the matter. Most people in the United States are not in the least concerned as to whether Great Britain survives or not. And what your dominions could achieve, those that is that remain, your dominions, is negligible. So, Mr. Shattuck, just how long, in your opinion, till people like yourself become reconciled to the situation?
Never, Mr. Rickster. Nor our children after us, nor their children's children.
Admirable. That is exactly what I hoped you would say. That is just the quality in the British that we Germans have always saluted. That infinite capacity for holding true to an idea. We too believe utterly and completely, individually and collectively, in our idea. We believe that it is our destiny to rule the world and by doing so, make it a better place. We have always believed that, and that is why at last it is coming true. We are also, Mr. Shattuck, a great deal more intelligent than your countrymen give us credit for. You, for instance, I'm sure, were convinced that when we invaded and conquered your country, we would immediately embark on a considered program of organized murder, rape, pillage, and destruction. Is not that so?
Yes.
Have we done so?
Not yet.
And why do you suppose we have been so restrained?
I should think you were waiting to see which way the wind blows.
Not at all. We know that already. Our policy in this country, contrary to all expectations, is essentially a friendly one. In that lies the genius of Hitler. the psychological intuition which enables him not only to dominate the human mind, but to understand the human heart as well. Believe me, the Führer is fully aware of the inherent greatness in this nation. He believes that the spirit of this country is indestructible. He believes, in spite of what you said just now, Mr. Shaddock, that ultimately, in so many years, Great Britain will become reconciled to the inevitable. Not through any weakening of her spirit, but through the strengthening of her innate wisdom and common sense. As soon as that innate wisdom and common sense reasserts itself, as soon as you're willing to renounce your imperialistic convictions and cut your losses sensibly and courageously, then we can stand firmly together, your country and mine, who have so much in common, and combine to drive the evil forces of Jewry and communism from the face of the earth.
There are lots of Jews in England, Mr. Richter, and lots of communists too. What's going to happen to them?
If the latter will change their views, the former will be liquidated or deported.
Liquidated?
A certain amount of ruthlessness is unavoidable when the end justifies the means.
I knew there was a catch in it. Last orders, please.
Well, thank you very much for that marvellous reading. I suppose that that would take us on to considering the kind of war work that Coward did do in the war. And I'm going to turn now to Brian Fillis, who has written a screenplay about Coward and particularly about his experiences in the war, Brian. Obviously, as part of developing your screenplay, writing the screenplay, you've done quite a lot of research into his experiences during World War II. Mm. Could you tell us a little bit about those experiences and how you think, from your own research, that the war affected him and you know, possibly as his work as a writer?
Well, I was drawn to writing about his war experience partly because to take, from my perspective as a writer, to take somebody who was known for being very witty and perhaps a little bit frivolous and insert him into a role that was very serious and very important and then for us to discover that actually he was terribly good at it was tremendously exciting. And I think that what endeared me immediately to the project was that his cover was being Noël Coward. That was precisely the reason he was seen as having potential as a spy. Who would expect Noël Coward to be a spy? I mean, it's absurd. But it also came at a cost for him because quite a lot of the work that he did was in America, where he was sent to, first of all, to find out how the level of sympathy that the Nazi cause was getting in New York and Washington and Hollywood, and also to flush out, if he could, any Nazi agents. And his cover was, well, you're Noël Coward, you're sunning yourself in LA, you're going to parties in Washington and mixing with the great and the good. This, of course, went down very badly at home. The newspapers roasted him for this. And his controller saw that as proof that the cover was working. And he went to his controller, Bill Stevenson, and said, there is no way that somebody can tell, just not give them a wink, a little indication that I'm doing something important. No. So he had to carry this to his grave. The better he did the job, the more he was vilified for it. And I think that affected him quite significantly. Because I think what took him into this war work was, I get the sense that somewhere around the point at which he's turning 40, Noël was seeking for a validity beyond merely being a playwright, or a playwright known for writing very kind of witty dramas. We know that he was courting Virginia Woolf quite heavily in the 1930s, looking for some kind of approval from somebody who was considered to be of a higher artistic plane. And of course, she gave him very short shrift. And it's possible to interpret his desire to do war work in that context. He's seeking for some kind of validity. And of course, yes, notionally, he achieved that validity, but no one was allowed to know about it. So in a way, I think I like to think that he came out of the war looking back and saying, well, actually, I did something that's important. I know about it. And from that point on, I think he becomes a much more comfortable human being. I have, this might be the writer in me putting a construction on his experience, but I feel that he came out of the war feeling, actually, I'm happy with what I did, and I'm happy with what I do. And from that point on, I think he was, we know that around that time he met Graham Payne, and I think that that gave him a lot of stability from that point on in his life. So that the story has a happy ending, basically.
That's always good to hear.
Oh, yes.
I mean, I think in terms of his espionage work, I know, Francis, you had thoughts a little bit about the kind of work that he was doing, because he was actually very involved in espionage work, wasn't he, throughout the war? And it was something that he was, you know, incredibly involved in. But, of course, he had this problem that nobody could know about it because of the nature of the work he was doing.
Yeah, I mean, he was fairly confidently expecting a knighthood at the end of it all. And I think he was really upset not to have got one.
Well, he ended up in court, didn't he?
Yeah.
Because he was spending money abroad, and it was his money. He wasn't taking a salary for his job, but you're not allowed to spend a certain amount, over above a certain amount, you're not allowed to spend British currency overseas during the war. So when they discovered how much he'd been spending, they took him to court. So quite the reverse of giving him a knighthood. They punished him for it. Mm.
Do you think there would have been, you know, ulterior motives or reasons why they wouldn't give him the knighthood at that point? Do you think it was you know, possibly he'd done this work but they didn't want to acknowledge it, or was it a bit of a closed shop? You know, I mean, any ideas? Because he did get the knighthood in the end, thank goodness, didn't he?
Eventually. I mean, I think because of the press coverage, he was toxic. I think that Churchill felt the press. We have to endorse what the press have said about, or we can't contradict what the press have said about him. And on that basis, we can't be seen to be awarding somebody who seems to spend a large portion of the war sat by a swimming pool in LA with Cary Grant. It's just not on, really.
And it's still a very homophobic world. I mean, Gielgud had to wait an age for his knighthood, too. Mm-hmm.
Yes, so that might have played a part. But, you know, it does sound like he came to terms with the war work that he'd done, and not, you know, it not being able to be recognised. You know, that's an interesting point, that actually perhaps, you know, in your creative look at his life, in your work, that he came to a point of, you know, he knew what he'd done and he was happy with what he'd done in terms of his war work.
Yes, I mean, I'd see things like Janet's speech in A Piece in Our Time as Coward partly saying, I was perhaps mistreated, personally I was mistreated during the war, but my belief in England and Britain is undimmed. Mm. You didn't take that from me in the way in which I'd been mishandled. And I'm sure that Coward recognised that there were reasons why certain things took place and why his cover had to be kept, of course. But I think he wanted to send us, perhaps, again, it's the writer in me, that he wanted to send a signal to the powers that be. It didn't work. I'm still here, and I still believe that it was a good idea, and I still believe in England.
Thank you. Well, that takes us on rather nicely to our next reading from the play. We're moving on slightly in the chronology of the play, and we're moving on to episode 6. I'll hand over again to our actors.
Liar Vivian, she seemed nervous to me, Fred, sort of strung up. Something's happening.
Something's always happening.
They'd never have risked sending her here through Dr. Venning's yard and the back way and everything unless it was important. I wish Doris had come home. I'm worried.
Look, it's no use being worried, dear. The only thing to do is to sit tight and hope for the best.
She said Doris was being followed home.
Well, that's nothing. We're all followed every time we go out. We're all on the suspect list ever since that little rat Bannister gave us away, ever since the raid.
We haven't any proof that he gave us away.
Proof? Who else could it have been? You saw him with your own eyes sneaking out. And if you hadn't, we should be behind the barbed wire by now, or dead. But the fact that they didn't find anything that time doesn't mean they've given up. They'll go on watching us now until kingdom come.
It's Doris I'm worried about. She might have done something foolish.
I don't fuss, Mother. She's got her head screwed on, all right.
I knew Mrs. Braid oughtn't to have lost her temper that night. It all started then with you trying to be funny and mixing his drinks and making him sick.
I wish it had been prussic acid instead of dear old Stubbs.
I've got a feeling that something's gone wrong.
You've had that feeling every day and night for over 2 years, ever since Stevie came back.
Well, it's different now. They suspect us. They know we're up to something. Otherwise, they wouldn't have come out that night and ransacked the house and the cellar and...
But they didn't find anything. Everything was cleared and everybody was gone an hour before they got here. And they can't find anything now. Not if they search till they're blue in the face. We're out of commission.
I know all that.
But what?
We ought to go away, Fred. You and me and Dory, somewhere in the country.
How could we, without a permit?
We could go to Ethel in St Albans. She's going to have a baby anyhow, and she is a relative.
Oh, it'd be a nice job convincing the authorities that the whole lot of us have to shut up shop and go to St Albans just because your cousin twice removed is going to have a baby. Besides, what about Stevie?
We're no use to Stevie anymore. We're more a danger to him than an help. We haven't even seen him for 3 weeks.
The pub's our livelihood. It's stayed open all through the bad times and it's going to go on staying open. You and Dory can go if you like, though I doubt if you'll persuade her to, but I'm staying here.
Don't be unkind, Fred. You know I wouldn't leave you.
Listen, love. I know it's awful for you. I know the strain of never knowing what's going to happen from one minute to the next is getting you down. I know you're eating your heart out with anxiety and worry and that you're frightened out of your wits, not for yourself, but for all of us. But I know, and you know too, inside, that we can't run out now. Not now, just when things are coming out right at last. May only be a question of a few weeks before the day comes, before we're set free again. We can't not be here to see it happen. This is where we belong. We've stuck it out through all the nightmare years of shame and defeat. We can't not be here for the victory.
Very well, dear. Have it your own way. It's just on six. We'd better open up.
That leads us rather nicely into thinking about some of the challenges that are involved in adapting this play for radio. And I'm going to turn to Martin Wade, who is a very experienced dramatist for radio, but he did a brilliant job of adapting Coward's work for the radio with Peace in Our Time. And for those of us who don't really understand, don't write for radio, Martin, could you explain to us what are the difficulties, what are the challenges of adapting a play like Peace in Our Time for the radio?
Well, first of all, there are a huge number of characters. I think at the last count it was something like 40. And if Noël Coward were to be alive today and present his idea for a play to BBC Radio Drama and tell the commissioning editor, well, there are going to be 40 characters in the play, eyebrows would be raised. So that was a problem in itself, because one had to think about character identification. One had to think about maintaining the character's presence throughout a particular scene. And one had to organise their comings and goings so that the entrances and exits were signalled in radiophonic terms, in a clever sort of way, one hopes. Whereas on stage, it's crystal clear what's happened. So that was a problem.
And I think there was a particular device you used to get around the problem of setting a scene, you know, on radio, where if we're watching the play in the theatre, we can see what's happening. You don't have to explain characters coming and going, who they are. You did one particular radical, interesting thing with the play, didn't you? And you introduced a new character to the play to help you with stage directions, that sort of thing. Could you tell us a little about that?
Well, the character is Noël Coward.
Ah.
Yes. When one is adapting a stage play for radio, the very clever thing to do is to suggest what is happening, to create the setting and to move the play on, simply by making changes to the dialogue, little insertions here and there. But I decided, particularly because of the large cast, that that wasn't on, really. I couldn't cope with that. The next thing to think about was whether I wanted one or two of the characters, perhaps, to take on the role of narrator. And I considered that for a while and then thought that perhaps that was going to single out characters because they were now seen as narrating as well as taking part in the play. And that would give a kind of bias towards those characters, which I didn't want. So plumped for Noël Coward as narrator and used his introduction to the play, the set and the situation. So I scavenged some of that and also used the little pen pictures that he gave of the various characters and slotted those in when the various characters appeared.
Well, I think that's a good cue to give us another example of Stephen doing his absolutely marvellous impression of Noël Coward. I think this is taken from episode 3 of the radio adaptation, and this next section really demonstrates for us what Martin's just talking about there, using Coward, including Coward as a character, to, you know, act as a narrator, really, for the play. So I'll hand over to Stephen.
January 1942. Well over a year since Britain was occupied by Nazi Germany. The saloon bar of the Shy Gazelle near to closing time. Chorley Bannister is drinking with Bobby Paxton, a sleek young man of pleasant appearance but somewhat repellent personality. Gladys Mott. That's her. She's drinking with a German soldier. She's dressed like a... Well, you can imagine how she's dressed. In the corner, Herr Huberman and his wife. They're clerks in one of the ministries. Near to the door is Alfie Blake, who looks like a ticket tout. He's reading a sporting paper and trying to make his glass of beer last as long as possible.
Fantastic. Thank you, Stephen.
Could I just say, I felt absolutely vindicated in my decision to have Noël Coward as narrator when I heard Stephen Critchlow's performance.
Yes, I think we'd all agree with that. He's absolutely marvellous. I think that you were able to get around some of the difficulties of visual events happening, which, if we're putting the stage, the play on stage, would be obvious to the audience. But I can think of a couple of occasions in the play, events happening which are quite pivotal to the plot. And I just was interested if you could explain to us how you got around those problems. I'm thinking particularly there's a scene where Chorley Bannister, who's really the sort of one of the baddies of the piece, overhears a secret discussion. It's a bit like in Hamlet with this sort of hiding behind the arras and overhearing a murder plot. How did you get around that for the purposes of letting the radio audience hear what was, understand what was going on, where somebody's off stage and the people in the audience at the theatre would know that they're off stage? How did you get around that in the play?
Well, the situation is that this Chorley Bannister character, the little rat, who's an intellectual and a Nazi sympathiser, I don't know whether the two inevitably go together, he has had something put in his drink. It's actually Stubbs's beer, which everybody else seems to be able to manage, but he can't. So he's feeling a little ill, and when it's closing time, instead of leaving the pub, he goes into the gents. We know it's the gents because he's been in there before with a German, when the German had drink spilled over him. So the stage then is empty in the play, and the resistance folk come onto the stage and start talking about their plans. Now, for radio, this doesn't work at all because we need to think about Chorley Bannister when he's coming back, as he does, after the resistance chaps have had their conversation. And we get an idea in the stage play that he's been listening to what has been going on. he appears when the stage is empty and then leaves the pub. So I decided that the best thing to do was to, as it were, open the play out and follow Chorley Bannister into the gents. So we hear him being a little bit ill in the gents, and as he's there, we're with him, and as he appears from the gents, he begins to hear the conversation that is taking place in the main saloon bar. And so we get a clear idea from doing it that way, being with Chorley Bannister in the gents, that he has overheard the conversation that's going on.
You make that sound very simple, Martin. I should imagine, in terms of writing that, though, and coming up with the device and thinking about how that would play out, it's fiendishly difficult. But you do sound that, you make that sound terribly easy. You're being modest. We'll allow you to be modest. But having heard it...
Well, it's just a matter of thinking about it in a radiophonic way.
Yes.
It was, as far as I was concerned, the only way in which it would work. We had to follow Chorley into the gents and be with him, overhearing the conversation. And that was the only way I could make it work. Yeah. Because it was working in stage play visually, but orally we had to take it a different route.
Well, congratulations, because I think, having heard it, of course, I think you did a super job, so Thank you. Well done. I'd like to bring in Kate now, because Kate directed the radio adaptation of the play. And Kate, can you tell us a little bit about the challenges of adapting a theatre play for radio, particularly thinking about characterisation, for example?
Yes, well... Thankfully, Martin knew the play so well, all 40 characters, that if I ever went, can we have that person also play that role? He's like, no, because they're the next page. So we did manage to do it with 20 actors, which is still a lot for a radio production. And I'm proud to say that we had some very experienced cast, but we also took people fresh from their first job. I went up to Edinburgh Festival and recruited young German officers, which is great. And so our experienced cast were able to mentor them in the ways and whys of radio acting, which is very different. At one point, we cheated, and the editor and myself slowed down someone's voice. In fact, it ended up being Gladys Mott, because she was also played the character of Doris. And because she's such a young girl, we wanted to make a distinction. So we slowed her voice down in the edit suite, and she came up to me after and said, I didn't know you recast that. And we said, no, we didn't, it's you. We just slowed you down just a tiny bit, and you sound a bit like you've had 40 gitans for breakfast. So that was a challenge. And also, I was really, really keen to record it in the right order, because I think the story arc is very important. You know, we got that bunker feel, didn't we, by the end? I'm looking at the actors there. Because we recorded it on location, sadly we couldn't use the actual pub that it's set in, which we wanted to, because that's very busy. It's off Sloane Square and full of drinkers all day. So we used a basement bar in Soho, which was fantastic. I thought, oh dear, we haven't got a green room, that's a problem, where are the actors going to go? But of course, the actors sat to the side, and if I ever did need more muscle and more sound of feet, I'd just, come back on, please, come walk over there. Because radio is close to film, in that you have to suggest a location, you have to know your geography. And I hope that we've achieved that. People say who listened to it all in one go, they said, oh, yeah, I really knew where the gents was. So I could tell where that character was going off to, where the back door was. Of course, it took hours in post-edit, because every time that door opened, we had to have the sound effect of the door. We had to have the traffic outside. The door then had to close. Nipper then had to bark. By the end, I was like, oh, cut Nipper, please, please. It was really good to do it in that way. And I think we had external noise. Alison had to keep running up to the builders who were working on the next door building and ask them to stop drilling just for 2 minutes so we could take a recording. And it's really important, again, to actually go through the motions. So by Friday afternoon, where we got to the scene, where Albrecht is being tied up, and he's about to be shot. He doesn't know this, but he's been tied up. He has to have water thrown in his face. And Nora comes close up and says, "You deserve this." We had Stephen, who had a plastic bag on his head, had several people's scarves wrapped around them, and having water thrown in his face. And I normally direct with my eyes closed for radio. So I was sitting there listening, and myself and the production assistant took one glance at Stephen, and that was it. We lost it. We laughed so much that we had to do the whole thing several times, because I think it's fair to say he also felt slightly ridiculous with his plastic bag on his head that could make the noise of this hat that was given to him. So it was much more stage-like than you would think, in that we went through the real processes. But I really couldn't have done it without a fantastic script, and obviously being allowed to use the play in the first place. So we thank Alan Brodie for that. But it's been, yeah, it's been a joy to do.
Before we move on to our next extract from the play, could you talk to us about the use of an announcer, the idea of a radio within a radio?
Yes, the announcer, in a bit like Martin was saying about setting the scene each time with Coward's voice, which we came to think as a good way of moving the play on. Also, in the pub, there's two different radio channels. There's the official radio channel, which the occupied armies tell you what's going on. And then, of course, there's the resistance. So they have to close all the curtains, wait till everybody's left the pub, and then you get this wonderful crackle noise. So it's kind of, yeah, a play within a play, radio within radio. But that gives us an idea of what's happening. But I think in this piece now, we've got the official version that's going to happen.
That brings us nicely into an extract from episode 5 of the play to give you an example of how that announcer situation works. So handing over to the actors once more.
A January evening in 1945. Almost 3 years since Fred and Nora's son, Stevie, made his unexpected appearance at the Shy Gazelle. The place is a little scruffier now, and the curtains have been replaced by heavy blackout material. There aren't many customers in the saloon tonight, just Alma Borton, the Grangers, and Alfie Blake and his wife. Like the pub, it must be said, customers and staff look shabbier than before, and everybody, in one way or another, betrays weariness and strain. Fred and Nora seem to have aged more than a period of 3 years would warrant, and Doris looks pale and tense, as though she's constantly controlling her nerves. It's 9 o'clock, time for the news.
As announced in a previous bulletin, the attempted invasion by British, American, and French forces of southern France and the Bay of Biscay area has been repelled, with enormous Allied land losses. A statement issued earlier this evening by the governor of occupied Britain points out that this sensational victory should disprove once and for all the lying propaganda and false rumours spread by subversive elements in order to encourage resistance towards the occupation authorities. Rumour mongers are acting against the best interests of British people and will be dealt with summarily and without mercy. The united Europe of the Third Reich will not tolerate traitors. That is the end of the news. Listeners are reminded that the penalty for tuning into any except officially sanctioned broadcasts is death. Good night.
It would be wonderful now to turn to Geoffrey to get a perspective of somebody who knew and worked with Sir Noël Coward, and we're incredibly grateful to you, Geoffrey, for taking part in the discussion. Obviously, you didn't know Sir Noël in the aftermath of the war. I think you probably met him 15, 18 years after the war had ended. Yeah. Could you give us a little bit of an idea of what he was like as a person from your own experience, and what he was like to work with? And did he ever mention the war? I should ask that first of all.
Well, I think maybe I told you this by email. He, when I knew him, he never mentioned the war very much, except he did say that, I hope I'm not treading on your territory in any way, because you've done a great deal of research, and you probably know far more than I do about what he did and how he performed during the war. But he always said that it was really now he's become known in America as a kind of spy. That's his other role, aside from being a wonderful playwright, et cetera, et cetera. All the other things, songwriter, all the other things he did. But he always said that the government really didn't give him, the English government didn't really give him a chance. Mm. They didn't really use him well. And you may know all of this, I may be repeating, that he said he had to find out what was going on in the war by reading the Daily Mail. He said, I found out things, that I should have known. Mm. So he said, my whole life in Paris when I was there was really social. Mm-hmm. And that was one of the reasons, I think, that was his cover. You were talking about his cover, I think, was that he would be very social and he was Noël Coward, so nobody thought he'd be, working for the government, that sort of thing. But I think that was the extent of it as far as what I found out.
Well, I think I'd be right in saying that he really, obviously the people who have joined us today know of the extent of his fame at that point. He had the entree to every dining room, living room, drawing room around the world, really, didn't he? So he was uniquely placed to be able to go over to the States, for example, and from that espionage position, he was in a great position where he could, everybody, the Roosevelts and the Churchills, would all welcome him into their homes, wouldn't they?
And I think he was at friendly odds with Churchill. I never got quite that, relationship, because I think you said that Churchill said, go and entertain the troops, which he eventually did during the war, but. Churchill wasn't very sympathetic, and it was Stevenson that really got him, into the game, into the war game. But he did know everybody. I mean, he knew everybody. Mm-hmm. It was incredible. And he managed, as I'm sure you know, because you've done all this research, he managed when he got to America to get to Roosevelt. I don't quite know how that happened, you probably do. I think Churchill was a little pissed off at that, if I may say so, would be right. Anyway, that's the extent of my knowledge of the war years.
I would have thought all of these people would be fans, wouldn't they? Really. I mean, he would have been, if Sir Noel said he was going to turn up, you'd be delighted to have him in your house, wouldn't you?
Oh, sure. Yeah. And, he was great company. And, of course, he was one of the quickest people I've certainly ever met in my life. I mean, I remember once, I have all these sort of dining out stories about him, but, once I was visiting Switzerland, and we were all going out in the snow, we were going to drop a name or so. We were going to David Niven's for Boxing Day, and there was a terrible. There had been a terrible snowstorm, so I had to sit down on a chair to put my snow boots on. And he said, "Would you please get up? I wrote Cavalcade." He would do that. I can't do an imitation of him. you do a much better one. He was very fast, and he wasn't being nasty. He just, one of his, I need to sit down because I need to put my boots on. Why are you sitting there? You're just, this strange American that's come up to visit for Christmas. But anyway.
I should think that quickness and that wit would have been fantastically useful for a spy, wouldn't it? Those are the kind of techniques that you want.
Oh, yes.
I think you mentioned Bill Was his name Little Bill? Was that who I know Francis? Was it Little Bill who was trying to? Yeah. Who was a sort of spy runner or that had different espionage agents working for him?
Espionage, right?
He was control, wasn't he?
Yeah, right.
Did he control another writer that we know?
Well, Cary Grant was one of his boys, and David Niven. They were all kind of
really.
Yes,
oh, I didn't know that.
They were all spying for Bill. Yes.
Did I also read that Ian Fleming?
I think
was run by Little Bill. Is that?
I don't think Fleming was.
I think
in
they
America
knew each time. Other very well. Yeah. I didn't know that there was any spy control there.
I read that just before he went to America, they took him to Bletchley. To get the induction, and they couldn't find it. He was driven there by a captain. They couldn't find it. They got out their car. They're looking at their map, and a local passed by and said, "Are you looking for the secret government plane?" yes, we are actually. Yes. Just down there into the left. Thank you.
You see, today, looking back on those years that I knew him and worked for him. There's so many things I regret that I didn't pursue and ask him about. But I think there were always a lot of other people around, mm-hmm. Whether it was Cole Leslie or Graham Payne or Gladys Calthrop and all his, what I called his family, that he was very close to. And I mean, it wasn't all the dressing gowns and the cigarette holders and all of that. He really cared about that people. Mm-hmm. I always said I was a stepchild. I came from America, and I wasn't really in like Lynn. But there were only occasional times when I was alone with him. But he was always interested in my life. And he was always interested in everybody. But I guess that's part of being a genius, a genius writer. And I remember once in New York, I had to go to his apartment to get him to take him to an interview. And I said, now, we have to meet whoever, New York Times, whatever, at Sardi's or wherever it was. And you must be ready by, we have to be there by 12 o'clock. It's an important interview for one of the shows. And so I got to his apartment about 11:45, and he was still in bed. But he was talking to, I guess you call them, the Daily. And he was getting the story of her life. And she had come from someplace in Middle Europe. And he wanted to know all about her. And I said, we have to go. I mean, it's not easy to start ordering Noël Coward around. But I finally got him, to get dressed very quickly. And we actually got there on time. I couldn't believe it. But as I say, I just wish there were so many things I could have asked him. Then, particularly about the early years, those years in the 20s and at the time of the vortex and all of that.
Well, possibly like the rest of his generation, I should think he probably didn't talk about the war very much after the war had ended. Perhaps peace in our time was sort of an ending in a way to wrap up that part of his life. Right. They got on with their the rest of their life and moved onwards, perhaps. But it's fascinating to hear that your insights on knowing him, Geoffrey.
Right.
And
may I just say this? When I was playing the discs of your radio broadcast, I thought I love this play. I think it's a wonderful play. I had read it very early on, but I saw it about 6 or 7 years ago. The production in Los Angeles, and it was all Americans, and they were terrific. It was great, and it was beautifully directed, and it was adapted and cut, which I think it needs to be, but in my opinion. But I thought, he was very, very patriotic. Yeah. He really was. He really cared very, very much about England. It's like I was at. Here, just one more, and then I'll shut up. I was at a screening at the theater in London near the National Theater where they do films. Yeah. They just do films.
The BFI.
Yeah, the BFI, and they were doing a sort of a Noël Coward festival quite a while ago, and so afterward they had a talk back thing with him. And so they were out to get him, which they often were, the press. And they said, you know, you say you love England so much. One of the reporters got up and said, what, you love England so much? Why do you live in Switzerland? He looked out at the audience and he said, I like chocolate. And so the reporter shut up. That was the end of it.
Oh, that's fabulous, Geoffrey. Thank you so much for sharing those personal memories of Sir Noel. You know, we're incredibly grateful to you for sharing those, because that's, you know, wonderful. I think that probably we're slightly running out of time now. There's a lot more to be said about Noel Coward's work and Peace in Our Time in particular. You know, I very much hope that you've enjoyed this morning's discussions about the play and Sir Noel's work in World War II. The Noel Coward Society has very kindly put together an information pack about Peace in Our Time, which I hope you've been able to get a copy of, but if you haven't, we've got more copies and we can hand those out as you leave. I hope you'll join me in thanking all of the panel members for sharing their wisdom and insight. Also our wonderful actors, Stephen Critchlow, Dorothy Atkinson and Adrian McLaughlin. Marvellous. And also a great big thank you to Stephen Greenman from the Noel Coward Society, who sadly had to dash away this morning, who was instrumental in bringing the event together. We'd also like to thank the Noel Coward Theatre for very kindly hosting the event. We're very grateful to them for that. To Alan Brodie Associates, and also the Noel Coward Foundation for their support in the production of Peace in Our Time and today's event. I should shamelessly end on a really shameless plug that if you would love to listen to our radio adaptation of Peace in Our Time, we have got some limited edition CDs of the play that are on sale in the foyer. So please do come and find us, and if you'd like to take one of those away with you, we'd be delighted. And thank you so much for coming, and I hope please do.
I'll interrupt you just once.
No, please do, Geoffrey.
I just want to say I'm very impressed by this whole group. I really am. And I mean it when I say I've learned something today.
Oh, fantastic.
And it was, I think you've all done a wonderful job, all of you.
Well, thank
really
you very
that.
Much.
I mean that.
Well, thank you.
Don't let the beast to the Germans when our victory is ultimately won. It was just those nasty Nazis who persuaded them to fight, and their Beethoven and Bach are really far worse than their bite. Let's be meek to them and turn the other cheek to them and try to bring out their latent sense of fun. Let's give them full air parity and treat the rats with charity, but don't let's be beastly to the Huns.